Welcome back to the PFC podcast. The views and opinions you are about to hear are the speakers and do not necessarily reflect those of anyone else. Now on to the podcast.
Welcome back to the PFC podcast. This is Dennis, and today I am with Casper and Paul. How are you guys doing today?
Hey, thanks, Dennis. I'm doing good.
Thanks, Dennis. I'm doing good as well.
Perfect. I got to say, Paul, you're looking good with that beard.
Thanks, man. I've been putting a lot of work into it.
Good, good. So today, I'd like to talk about kind of a leadership tool or an acronym called the Tactical Timeout. But quick, before we get into that, everybody knows you, Paul, but Casper, if you wouldn't mind doing a quick introduction of yourself.
Absolutely. I'm Casper. I'm from the Netherlands. I'm a NATO Special Operations combat medic for 4 years already, I think. Before that, I was a Special Force medic in the Netherlands Maritime Special Operations Force.
Okay, perfect. So let's just kind of start off, like, what is a tactical timeout?
Do you want to start off, Casper?
Yeah, I will start off with it. I think most of us in the medical community already know the timeout that you use, for example, on the operating theater for the surgeons to make sure that they don't cut off the left leg instead of the right leg. And we sometimes, or a lot of times, we also use it in the soft medical context. For example, when you're doing march on at the end of the primary survey, you can do a small timeout with your team to discuss what do we have here and what are we going to do next. And I think Paul and I try to bring that to make that a bigger thing that you can also use in situations like prolonged field care.
Okay, perfect. So, Paul, like, why did you bother coming up with this?
Yeah, that's a great question, Dennis. We were doing a prolonged field care scenario, and Casper's team was doing patient care, and they stopped to do a normal timeout like they would normally do. And it was phenomenal. I don't think I had ever seen a team do a timeout like that, especially not in that depth. And it really set everybody's expectations. They were all equal. Everybody was on the same page. And from there on out, they had the medical care, the plan, the nursing care kind of all set. Meanwhile, there were some things going on around us that some people were not aware of. So somebody went outside, there was a situation out there where the rest of the team was not aware of that. And so while Casper was doing that, I was like, hey, why don't you add some of these other tactical considerations onto what you guys just did to get everybody's mind in the same operational context, not just the medical context. And I think from there, during the scenario, he and I were kind of throwing back and forth some of these ideas, and it pretty much grew on the spot during one of these scenarios. And it was truly a collaborative effort to figure this out. And since then, I've seen a couple of his teams use it again. And when I see teams use this versus teams that do not, there's a clear cohesion that happens after good communication like that. And I think we take that stuff for granted. But we did throw around some of these different acronyms and mnemonics and things to kind of help us with that. But I think we settled on the SOCKS P after some deliberation. But Casper, what do you think about that?
Yeah, I think it's nice to mention that you called me towards you and said, yeah, why don't you also put in the tactical considerations? And we were writing it on our phone while on the job. And exactly, yeah, as you say, Paul, if I now, for example, do a prolonged field care exercise with other teams and I see things going a little bit to the south, I always say, here, look what I have, and I show it on my phone. Try to use this. I tell it to the tactical team leader or the team sergeant major or who is in charge. And you will see immediately after they did one of the timeouts with the tactical situation, the medical situation, etc., etc., it will change and everybody is getting on the same page.
Now, I mean, it truly does make a difference.
Yeah. So, yeah. I mean, I understand for a surgery, you know, doing a timeout for legal reasons, you know, make sure you got the right patient, make sure you're going to do the right procedure, etc. But I mean, from what you guys are describing, that is like a team sergeant's job, like organizing things, having everything understood, all the information gathered. And my job as a medic is to just go and do, you know, like, why is it I need an acronym, another thing on me, when this is clearly, this is another guy's job?
Yeah, I can answer that. And I would say that that's an absolutely wrong way to look at this, because everybody's job is security first and foremost. So I think I would throw that back to you saying, you're not going to be able to do any medicine if everybody's dead, if things are compromised, if the operational situation goes south. So for us, we put that thing right at top. So security first, operational consideration second, before we even start talking about anything medical. What about you, Casper?
Yeah, I totally agree on that. And I also think most of the time, you or me as a medic, we know exactly what's going on with our patient and the patient next to us. And maybe in a mess scale, you know more about other patients as well. But your job is to zoom in and to zoom out. And the tactical timeout format will help you to zoom out not only to the patient left and right of you, but also to the team that's giving security to you, and also the bigger tactical situation or the bigger tactical picture around you. Because we shouldn't forget that we are there to conduct a military operation and not a medical operation. So we have to bring the tactical part back into the medical part.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with that. Because, well, like you said, Paul, everybody's dead, nothing you're doing matters, right?
Yeah, but even pretty simple.
Just from the medical aspect, I see guys just like charging into procedures that they don't have the equipment for. They don't understand the aftercare that needs to be done to sustain such a thing, like, you know, narcotics to keep the patient down. A tactical thing. I'm starting into a procedure that can take, you know, 10 minutes, 20 minutes, an hour, and they don't understand, when are we going to have to move? Like, what's going on around me that maybe this is not the right time to do such a procedure? And they just dive right into it. And then the thing happens. And now we have to rush to either finish or bandage things up, and now it's halfway done and it's a big mess and we have to transport, which again, we're not prepared for that either.
It can be even worse that you just used your last critical supply for that one procedure and you're 5 minutes into that procedure, and then the tactical commander or the tactical team leader decides the tactical situation is changed right now, we have to move. And you can't use your critical supply anymore because you now used it half. And the tactical commander, I think most of the time, has the whole tactical situation in his mind, and he has to bring that to the team. So you can make medical decisions based on the tactical situation.
Yeah, absolutely. So if we could, let's hit this acronym. Just one at a time. So what kind of things should we be worried about with security?
I think first off, you're going to have to know your operational environment. And that's something that goes back to our basic 101 soft mantras, is know your operational environment. And it's going to change. So you could be in the same physical location, but things around you could be changing rapidly. And if one person knows what's going on, but the rest of the team does not, they could very easily put the rest of the team at risk by doing something that is, you know, let's say all of a sudden noise and light discipline are important and somebody flips on a light and boom, now there goes your situation, your location that you just gave away. Same if you're in a more quiet type neighborhood or area, and now everybody's in there and they're laughing and joking, getting really loud. I've seen that many times where you just get a little complacent. And if you do these tactical timeouts, it kind of reels everybody back in.
Yep, absolutely. And just for the civilian providers that are not military or tactical, I mean, this could be any kind of danger. You know, it could be weather. It could be, you know, the civilian populace around you, right, is now starting to change. So just the general concept of keeping your head on a swivel and communicating amongst the rest of the team about what is known, right?
Yeah.
Yep. So under the next, under security, we have operational. So what do you mean by that?
Yeah, I can.
So to me,
I can
answer. You want to go, Casper?
Yeah,
sure.
In this part, we want to brief the whole team about the operational and evacuation situation that's currently going on. So what's going on in the area you're operating? What should we aware of? Where are forces advancing in combat? Where are people withdrawing? How does the front line move? How do we reach our objectives and whatsoever? And then also we want to discuss how are we going to evacuate the patients we have? So your primary aim as a first responder or a medical provider at point of injury is getting the patient off the X, right? So In this part, you also discuss with your team, how are we going to get the patients off the X here? Which patients go first? What evacuation platforms do we have? And what are their constraints?
Yep. And again, for the civilians, this ties directly into it. You're expecting a rotary wing, but the weather has come in now. So now we have to get them out on foot or, you know, whatever the situation, how it changes. You have to be aware of that and make sure that stuff is disseminated throughout. Paul, what about like contingency planning?
Yeah, these are some of those basic things that we kind of take for granted when we're in larger teams or we're in teams mixed with other tactical personnel and not just medical, where people are, you know, maybe on security or they're watching out for certain things. It kind of does tie back into security. Like if there is a situation where you need to leave like right now, everybody needs to know what that plan is, where you're going, who's taking what. Are you leaving the patient? Are you taking the patient with you? Are you going to give more sedation to the patient? So having things like that set up is a pretty good idea. And then if you have other things going on, like, in the civilian side, what if there's a fire? What if there's a flood? I mean, all these things have been happening pretty regularly in recent history. So you look across and see what's happening in Ukraine, and having a plan for each one of those and making sure that everybody knows what those plans are is going to save you so much time and communication that you don't have to do in the moment because you've already had those conversations beforehand.
Yeah. And I think you might maybe even going so far as before the mission, before the whatever, pre-labeling equipment, maybe with, you know, different colors of tape or some kind of markings on it. So, you know, hey, we have to bug out like now. We don't have the time or the strength to carry everything. Grab the stuff with the red tape on it. We got to go. You know, something like that, maybe.
Yeah, absolutely. What about you, Casper?
I'm definitely agree. And it's also a good moment to discuss, okay, is everything packed that we need to bring? Is there a big mess? Let's clean it up. You're going to clean it up. Make sure that the essential equipment is next to the door and you are going to take this with you. At the moment, we have to leave. We have a hard compromise or a soft compromise, or we have to leave like in 5-10 minutes. This is what we're going to bring.
Yep. So the next thing is shift change slash admin. So Casper, what is it that you mean by that?
Yeah. Here you will discuss with the team who of how the team rest cycle is going to work. So who is on shift, who is off shift, who is going to do what, who is going to take over which patient. So for example, you're taking over a patient from somebody, you tell it here, because the next part is the patient update. So you know, okay, if my patient is coming, I have to have full attention to this patient. Also in this part, you can talk about the supply plan. So what supplies are we short on? What do we need? Where are we going to get those? Who is responsible to get the supplies where we need them?
Yep. Paul, do you have anything to add?
No, I just want to reiterate that part that he said as far as when you're changing the shifts and you're letting somebody know, hey, your position from here on out, whether it's the next 2 or 3 hours, is going to be with that specific patient. That person's ears should then perk up in the next minute when we're talking about patient rounds, because you might have 4 or 5 patients and 4 or 5 providers. And if it's 3 or 4 in the morning, you're going to be pretty lackadaisical on your attention span. And so you could really tune in to the parts that are pertinent to you by the time you're getting down to this portion of the timeout.
Yep. So, and like you said, you know, shift change, 3 o'clock in the morning, the guy coming on tired, the guy coming off probably more tired. So is there like an acronym that you use to help with this shift change?
Casper, did you have an acronym?
We have an acronym for that. It's called SITVD. So you're talking about is the patient stable or unstable?
Sure.
What are the injuries? What's the treatment? The vitals, including the trend that's going on, with drugs and fluids that we give, and the nursing care plan. As described in the CPG from the joint trauma systems. And it's most important here that you mention the things that you can't see. So the things that, how do you say this, went into the patient. And when you're getting on your shift with the patient, when you expose the patient, look at the patient that you can't see. And you will update the patient one by one. So you will start with the patient one, and the provider that has been taking care of the patient will tell here those things to the whole team, and especially to the new guy that's going to be with that patient.
Yeah.
Yeah, perfect.
I think it's perfect because, you know, you got somebody coming in fresh, which is good. Like they have that, they're just fresh and they're able to make decisions. They have that kind of energy, but just getting them aware of what are the trends been, what are the big worries going forward? What is our supply status for that, you know, anticipated type procedures, things like that. And maybe even, you know, especially if you're dealing with non-medical personnel that are watching your patient, you know, your weight criteria, like, hey, heart rate's out of, you know, this range, you know, respiratory rate, et cetera, et cetera.
So what the aim is that you first update about the patient, what's going on, and then you can tell your treatment plan. And what I always like to do is that you outline the next 3 things you're going to do. So in the order that you want to do them. So the most important thing first. So then for everybody, it's clear those 3 things need to be done in the next hour, 2 hours, depends on the interventions. And of course, you then also, because you know the patient already, highlight the red flags. So as you already said, if another guy from the team is watching the patient, you tell them, listen, if the trend is going this and this way, then you have to wake up me or him or ask one of the other medics. And this is also an important moment, because here you can also discuss what essential supplies do I need And you hear this from all other patients as well. And this is also the moment that you find out that there's only one bag of blood and there are three patients that need that bag of blood in the next hour or next 3 hours or whatsoever. And then you can
we would never do that to you.
Yeah?
I said, we would never do that to you.
No. Definitely not. It's always. And then you can discuss with each other what which patient needed the most and where you're going to give it. So you don't have the discussion 10 minutes later when half the bag of blood is already in patient one, but patient three is more critical. So.
Yep. Now, to speak, he was talking about, wake-up criteria. Do you give your non-medics, say the patient, starts to be in pain or starts to get agitated or something like that, do you give them kind of the same kind of criteria as far as, hey, you can push, 20 micrograms of ketamine or milligrams, a couple milligrams of Versed. If you do that once or twice, then come wake me up.
We've been playing around a bit with this. And I think most medics that I know stick to, if the patient is getting his pain is more than 7, 6, 8, whatsoever, wake me up. And then we will discuss it. Or when the blood pressure is dropping beneath or above this line, wake me up. Most guys I know stick to that plan. But I know for sure, I'm sure that if you have cross-trained your team really well, it will provide you a lot of rest when you just tell them, okay, if this happens, do this. But it depends on your team.
Yep, absolutely. What do you think about that, Paul?
Yeah, if we're getting into specific things like that, I think with pain especially, it's worth noting, ask your patient, is your pain controlled? Do you need more pain medicine? Because I think in soft, a lot of times, either as a provider, and maybe this is everywhere, you kind of just take it for granted that he's going to grit his teeth and bear it. And a lot of times they do. And then later on down the road, you hear about I was suffering the whole time. Inversely, you do hear a lot of guys say, I am going to grin and bear it, and I'm not going to ask for pain meds. But if you tell this guy, hey, there's a thing called background pain, and then there's going to be breakthrough pain. And if we can control your pain now with an easy dose, we're not going to have to dose you hard later on. So it might be worth, if you have a conscious patient, having those conversations with them and say, hey, man, just be honest. Is your pain controlled, and do you need more pain medicine?
Yep. Because, once that pain, once you kind of lose control of it, it can kind of spiral pretty quickly to the point where you have to give some fairly large doses in order to get back under control. So it's far better to get it under control and do small bumps that are very safe to do to keep things under control than grin and bear it or just tell them to suck it up. And then have a major problem later on.
Yep.
So the next step in this is patience. So are we talking, I guess, how is that different than the update we gave during the shift change? Casper?
How do you mean, Dennis?
The P in the acronym says patience. Yeah. How is that different during the shift change update as far as using my SITS VD?
For me, that is the update you will do about the patients. And you can do it if there's a shift change, but you can also, and that's the next thing, here you can also, or at the end of the format, you tell to the team the next timeout will be at this and this moment. And then you can do, without a shift change, also a patient update to get everybody on the right page. And especially discuss treatment plans and essential supplies in it. So you can use it when there's a shift change, but you can also use it just to get all the heads together and align everything. So for me, that's the biggest difference.
Okay. So essentially, we're kind of organizing rounds, essentially. How often are you doing this? Like every 6 hours, every 12 hours, once a day?
So for Casper, me, what I would say, you want to say Casper, or I can enumerate? Okay, so for me, I think anytime there is a major change with some of the patients or the situation, this could be a lot. This could be very often. It could be 30 minutes. Let's do a quick rounds, or let's do a quick tactical timeout. Or if everything's steady, you're in the middle of the night, the patients are asleep, nothing's changing. Hey, maybe I can stretch that out to 3 or 4 hours and just do it at the shift change. But I think the main point is when there is a big change that affects everybody, everybody needs to know about it. And whether that's somebody just did a telemedicine call and got some good feedback from a doc, or the security situation has changed, everybody should be aware of those things. Now, if it's 3 in the morning, you did a telemedicine call and you guys are taking care of a patient, you probably don't need to wake everybody up just to tell them that. But when you do the next rounds and it's not so pressing, make sure that everybody knows.
Yeah. Yeah. Especially when you're talking, you know, anything that has to do with security or operational environment changes like that, everybody needs to know now.
So security is definitely the more important part for sure.
Yeah. Medically, if there's a drastic change from your, like a telemedicine call, you think you're good, and then you do a telemedicine call and you find out that you're really sucking and it's just a ticking time bomb. You got to get people aware of the problem. How does that affect your operation? How does that affect, the environment per se? Do we need to move up our evac in some way? How are we going to move forward now that we have this new information,
Yeah.
And of course, to add on, but I think it's quite a bit of an open door. It can also be that there's only a change in one patient, so you can go over the technical situation, and when it's already clear to everybody, because an hour ago there was a shift change, or 2 hours ago, you can also say no change in that. But I think you always have to make sure that if you do a shift change, so every 6, every 4, every 8 hours, whatsoever, what you do with your team, that's a good idea to mention everything. And in between, you can, if there's no update or no changes, just say no changes, everything clear for everybody, okay, then we go on. Make sure that it don't take a lot of time when it's not necessary. You know what I mean? You understand what I mean?
Yeah. Being efficient with your time.
Yeah, being efficient. Yeah.
Now also, we're talking about team internal. I imagine this will also affect my up and out communication when it comes to communicating with higher, my needs, receiving more information from higher. Does this acronym help me with my up and out type communication?
Definitely, in my opinion, definitely. So, Paul, how about you?
Yeah, I think that there could be stuff going on in the ground that is going to drastically change your up and out, like your operational picture, and those things do need to get sent up quick so that you can make those determinations, those decisions, and then roll with whatever you got. Yeah.
And patient care wise, he was stable. Now he's unstable. We need to push forward some kind of evac, or, we're going to need to put more effort into getting this guy out if we expect to save him. Right.
Yeah.
So Casper, you first. Is there anything else that we need to talk about that we didn't mention?
No, I have nothing else. I think everything is mentioned about it.
Cool. Paul, anything?
Yeah, the last thing that I would add, I don't think we've touched on this, but a lot of times as a junior medical guy, you're in the scenario, you're doing a lot of very specific patient care, things are changing around you, and then you finish a procedure or something that you're doing and you look up and there are things that you don't understand that's going on. And that should be a trigger for you to say, hey, guys, I don't know what's going on. Can we do a quick tactical timeout right now? And I saw this with Casper's team where it wasn't just the team leader who triggered the tactical timeout. It was whenever anybody was unsure of something, they knew and they spoke up and they said, hey, let's all come together, put our heads together real quick. They did their tactical timeout and then they got back to doing what they were doing, as opposed to now you have two or three people who are unsure. You don't know what's going on with the security situation. You don't know what happened with the telemedicine call. You're not sure what's happening with patients 2 and 4. And there's a lot of this confusion. If you're that guy, if you're the E3 or E4 or you know, junior medic on the team, and you raise your hand and say, hey, guys, I'm not sure what's going on. Let's do this real quick. It would probably be greatly appreciated because you're probably not the only guy on the team that's confused.
Yep, absolutely. You know, like they say, if you have a question, there's probably a lot of other people around you that have the same question.
Exactly.
It sounds good. Thank you guys very much for jumping on.
Yeah, thanks, Dennis.
Cool. Have a good night.
Thanks, you too.
For today's podcast, be sure to go to our website, www.prolongfieldcare.org. Find us on Facebook, YouTube, Instagram. Subscribe and stay on the bleeding edge of combat medicine. This is Dennis for the PFC Podcast. Out. Every boy is waiting there for you.